Hi, I'm Ed Kim. I am the physician in chief of City of Hope Orange County and will also serve as the vice physician in chief at City of Hope National Medical Center. I was born in Madison, Wisconsin. My mother is an artist, sculpture, painting, etc., drafter. My father was a finance professor. There was not a lot of medical influence in my family. I really had no desire to go into medicine, but we all have instances in our lives that change us. I have a brother, and he passed away at age 12 from a rare disease. It was very sudden, and at that point in my time, I was 14, I decided right then and there that I was going to pursue a career in medicine. It wasn't until my residency in Houston, Texas, that I encountered and met cancer patients. And they were battling, they had such a perspective that was so deep, sensitive, empathic. I said to myself right then and there, I need to work with this population of patients. These people are truly see the world in a different way. So ever since that time, I have devoted my life to research, study, treat cancer. And I was privileged enough to work at MD Anderson Cancer Center for over a decade, privileged to do some cutting-edge genomic personalized research. I've been in cancer now for over 20 years, and an opportunity to join City of Hope, the team, the research, the investigators, and especially the opportunity to help start something new. Build a second campus in Orange County. How can somebody say no to that? That is a fantastic opportunity, and I'm personally very excited to be here. I think the network we create in Orange County is going to allow us to connect so many more people, and they will feel confident that they are getting City of Hope world-class care.
Welcome back. If you didn't know, November is Lung Cancer Awareness Month, and we are so fortunate to have Dr. Edward Kim from City of Hope of Orange County with us today to talk not just about lung cancer and all the evolution of treatments and studies and all the good news, but to talk about hope in general. Dr. Kim, welcome to the show.
Thank you, Lauren. It's my pleasure to be here.
We're thrilled to have you and so grateful because City of Hope needs no introduction, and we're so happy to have you come share more about what is going on there. So why don't you tell us a little bit? You're new to City of Hope. How did you come to City of Hope?
You know, City of Hope is an amazing organization, one I've heard of, one I've looked at and admired for quite some time. When they made the call, I had just finished up building a new center and regional sites across the Carolinas. And it was something that I found a passion for, is that how can we build something, but also take that information, take it to the neighborhoods? How can we transmit expertise? And City of Hope was aligned with exactly what I was looking for. They wanted to build a second campus in Irvine. That's what we are doing right now, is investing $1 billion to build infrastructure so that the people in Orange County, 3.2 million people, can have world-class services that now are not an hour 30, depending on how the traffic is on the 405. And furthermore, not only building this campus, but spreading our expertise to the local neighborhood. And that's why we have sites such as Newport Beach, Fashion Island, Huntington Beach, and Irvine, and others, because we want to make sure that all parts of the county, and hopefully all parts of Southern California, have access to world-class care.
So you're actually opening 4 new locations, as I understand it. Is that correct?
4 and counting. So okay. I would say hope is growing, Lauren. So we are going to continue to cultivate it, grow, and make sure that we access all of the neighborhoods that need this type of help.
Amazing, Dr. Kim. My dad, just personally, when my dad was 42, he was diagnosed with a very serious brain cancer. It had been growing ever since he was a kid, and it was benign. And then about 5 years prior to him discovering it, there was a faster growing brain tumor that was malignant on top of it. And so I remember the day that my dad came into the house and sat us all down. I was 17 at the time. I'm the oldest of five. And he says, I have a brain tumor. And in order for me, it's serious enough that in order for me to have a shot, I have to fly to Duke. They have the best, you know, they have the best cancer surgery surgeons at the time they did. And so he went to Duke and underwent 12 hour surgeries and survived. And he's still alive today. And I'm so grateful, but I didn't see him for several months. And so as a senior in high school with like a, you know, a bunch of little brothers and sisters, that was hard for me. And so what I love about City of Hope and about this additional campus is that, you know, you're not only supporting the people who live here, but you're supporting everyone's families too, and giving them that support structure and making it so much easier for everyone to be able to, you know, get through it together.
You know, Amy, that I was hoping the story would go the way you took it, because it's too early in the morning not to have a sad story, but thank you for sharing that. I was picturing when you were sharing that story, sitting in the room with you all, maybe, you know, against the wall listening. And I can just imagine how everyone's just soul, heart sunk to below the basement level when that was saying. And I can only imagine what your father was going through, just trying to decide how he was going to tell everyone and into what details. And, you know, I'm glad he was able to share that with you all. And, you know, being a senior in high school and not seeing your father for 3 months and thinking every day what's going on, what's happening, that is an extremely stressful time. I agree with you. You know, I grew up in a small town in Indiana. We didn't have that type of care. We had to go to either Indianapolis or Chicago to just get good primary care services. Mm-hmm. My father had high cholesterol. No one could help him in the town, mm-hmm. believe it or not. So I resonate with that. And I do think that's what's really special about City of Hope. We just eat, sleep, breathe cancer. That's mm-hmm. all we do. Mm-hmm. You know, we are the only dedicated cancer center in California. And so, you know, that's who we want to take care of. And that encompasses not just the patient, the diagnosis, the treatment. We'll cure people. That's what we will do. But we have to also make sure the family is being taken care of. They are healed and being taken care of, because there are these other stressors that occur during the treatment, after the treatment, years afterwards, where people can have many different adverse effects, family members, patients. And so that's a big focus on what we have. I'll share with you that one of the programs that I'm bringing to Orange County is integrative medicine. Mm-hmm. And so we can make sure that we can take care of everything about a patient, including their family. And we've recruited a national expert who's going to join us, who will be based in Irvine and be able to spread that program across our enterprise. And so I'm very excited about that. Wow. He's very excited to join as well. Just to give you an example.
I'm so happy about this. This is such a, like, and especially for our viewers, where many of them have had cancer. Many of their family members have had cancer. What an amazing opportunity to have this level of service right in their backyard. Like, how amazing. I love it. So as you're building, you know, this infrastructure, you have four locations currently?
Yes, we have four. And, you know, everybody, just as you say, gets fixated on the diagnosis, mm-hmm. right? The diagnosis of cancer. You know, my early career when I started in cancer focused on prevention and chemo prevention. Mm-hmm. Because what's the best way to not have to deal with cancer is to not have to deal with it. Let's figure out how to prevent it. Let's make sure people are doing screening. And that's why, you know, November, I will say, is my favorite month. It's not because it's my birthday month, but also because it is Lung Cancer Awareness Month. And most people don't realize that about November. They're usually celebrating all of the relays and the races that occur in October from all the pink that we see of Breast Cancer Awareness Month. And then college football gets in the way and Thanksgiving. And then people, it was Lung Cancer Awareness Month. Right. So I'm really glad you're bringing some attention to this, but you know, we just encourage people to go out. We do have a great screening test for lung cancer now, but only 30% of the folks are utilizing
it. Really?
So who should get screened?
Yeah, so there are recommendations right now. We know that the number one cause of cancer is aging. So, you know, it's on the good side, it's great, but on the other side, you just gotta be more diligent. So anyone over the age of 50 who has had a 20 pack year smoking history. Now, what does pack year mean? Pretty simple. You think about how many packs a day you smoke. If it's two, let's say that, and how many years you smoked two packs a day. Mm-hmm. And you just do the math. So two, let's say you smoked for 10 years, you smoke two packs a day, that makes it 20 pack years. Mm-hmm. And if you are 20 pack years or more, then and over the age of 50, then you really need to talk to your doctor about CT screen, a low dose CT screening. It won't expose you to unnecessary radiation. And now it has shown, just like mammograms, just like colonoscopies, that is in the same category that you should be. And the tough part is that you won't be talking to a cancer doctor about this. See, I'm very well versed in this test because we see people who we find nodules in and eventually find early stage cancers. But you have to talk to your family doctor about this, your internist about this. And sometimes it's not top of mind when you're seeing.
So I think a lot of people won't think about this either. My brother's PhD thesis is actually around secondhand smoke and the impact on blood and heart function. But secondhand smoke was one of his biggest focuses early on. And that is a topic that we don't hear much about either. So what about those people being screened?
Yeah, that is a tough question, Lauren. And you know, it's interesting when you go to see your doctor, they usually ask you one question about your smoking history, right? Do you smoke? If you did, how long?
Right.
When I did research in tobacco and smoking prevention, we would ask about 35 questions about your smoking history or your exposure history, right? There are certainly occupational exposures. And just as you say, what if you never smoked, but you worked in bars or bowling alleys, or you were around people who smoked in cars or traveled on planes during this whole time when they allowed it, it's not accounted for. So we know that there is more exposure out there than just pack years. But unfortunately, that's the only thing we have to measure folks with right now, because it's hard to measure primary exposure with being around.
Mm-hmm. That makes sense. That's really interesting. So what's a good way to broach this with your family physician or your internist?
Yeah, I think the best question, and I think these days, really the pendulum is swinging. We need to make sure the person who is visiting is empowered with information, mm-hmm. right? You have to be your best advocate on this. Mm-hmm. The days when you just showed up to the physician's office and just said, okay, what do I do? There's just too much information out mm-hmm. there. You can't keep track of it. So I think people have to really take take command of their own health. And we want that. So just asking, what are the appropriate screening tests that I need to have? And that should trigger a discussion of mammograms, colonoscopies, and CT screening. And if you don't hear the answer, ask further. I think people get a little timid of asking a lot of questions to their physician. I think you should feel very, very empowered to do that, that it should be a two-way dialogue.
What about clinical trials? That's become a kind of buzzword now with COVID. People are suddenly aware of clinical trials where maybe they weren't before. But again, my brother's at the National Institutes of Health. We're a big family talking about clinical trials and how do you get involved and how actually prevention happens is through a lot of these studies. Are you entering that arena as well?
Well, at City Hope, we have a wide variety of trials, over 700, which is great. And I view clinical trials as essential in whether it's the prevention, the treatment, or the monitoring of cancer. Having done hundreds of them myself, I'm very close, and I know that these are the opportunities that really provide patients additional opportunities for success. And we know that the risks of a clinical trial is the drug may not work. Well, we also know that standard therapy isn't all that great, and that's why we have a clinical trial in that area to try and improve it. So I always encourage people, if they have any opportunity to do that. And I will say a couple of things. One is that it is essential. And one of the things we're doing at City of Hope is bringing these clinical trials to our regional sites. So you will see that occurring more and more frequently so that you don't have to travel long distances to have access to these clinical trials. You know, one of the biggest barriers we have is just distance. And that is enough to deter people from participating. The second is, and this is a part that it's really been close to me, and I've worked on this for about the last 7 years, and both of you have, you know, no ties to medicine. If I told you back in 2013 that I disagreed with what the eligibility criteria was on the template for clinical trials, and that's produced by the NIH and the NCI, and we needed to change it to reduce the number of eligibility criteria, I think many people would say, good luck. Yeah, nice try. 7 years later, we have partnered with multiple stakeholders, including Friends of Cancer Research, industry, patient advocacy groups, investigators, and we have led a series through the American Society of Clinical Oncology and Friends of Cancer Research to reduce and modernize eligibility. So we have actually reduced eligibility criteria on the CTEP protocol template. That's the NCI standard template. We've reduced it by almost 10 eligibility criteria. And on average, you'll find 35 to 40 eligibility criteria. Why is this important? Because being excluded from a trial for being a real-world population person is not fair. We need to make sure that the studies are reflective of a real-world population, that research is inclusive, and we cannot use small technicalities to keep people out of clinical trials, especially when we know when the drug's going to be approved, it will be to that exact person who is excluded. So this has been a mission. We've been successful. We've done two rounds of this, something I'm very proud to see continuing to move forward. And it will lead to inclusive research, which is what we need.
Dr. Kim, we could talk about this a lot. I know we could, just because it's something that's so personally interesting and also interesting for our audience, but where can our viewers get more information?
Yeah, the best place is to go to City of Hope's website and look for prevention and screening. We have information about our clinical trials, about our prevention programs, about all of our specialized programs. And again, it's an amazing group of physicians that we have, and staff, and nurses, and social workers. Everyone is very focused on just trying to make sure that we can treat the patient, their family, and their experience to the best. That website is www.cityofhope.org. And so if anybody wants to look at that, some people cite it's an unusual name for a cancer center. When I told my mother I was going to City of Hope, she said, well, which university is that? I said, it's not a university. It's a center that is dedicated completely to the care and the families of patients and families for cancer.
And how appropriately named, though, really.
Truly. It's a great name.
It's a great name. I'm sure your mother is ridiculously proud, as are we, to have you in Orange County as one of our family. So thank you so much for the amazing work you're doing. And we will look forward to bringing you back, because I know the developments that you're now undertaking are something that our viewers would certainly want to hear about. So thank you for joining us today.
I appreciate it, Lauren. Thank you, Amy.
Thank you so much.
And we'll be right back.